There is a South Park character creator, and I'm gonna create a character for Bonnie and for Raina, which is Bonnie. If you guys don't know, your lady friend Bonnie, who is our mod here, is behind that suit's lovely girlfriend or partner, however you want to say that, in the most PC way as possible, whatever. And Raina is my wife, so I'm going to create characters that represent them. And at first I told Raina is going to be like, they're going to be like shooting money at us, like strippers, like we were the strippers, but I can't do that kind of animation, so it's going to be a they're going to be doing whatever they're going to be doing. They're going to be doing it standing still and maybe going up and down. I don't know. They might just be in singing or something. I don't know. Everybody, let's go ahead. Mic up, Baron the Bard. Let's go ahead. Bring on today's guest.
Hey.
The wonderfully talented. The man from Boston. Or Texas, Baron the Bard.
Let's go.
Oh man, what is up? That's the hypest introduction I've ever had to anything I've ever done in life.
You're goddamn right it is. You're goddamn right it is, Baron. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you, my friend.
Yeah, my pleasure. That was a hell of a backdrop. We moved from homelessness to South Park to hype introductions.
We navigate through those choppy waters a lot here. We'll go from me crying to me talking about my dick in the same sentence. So it's a roller coaster ride around here, Baron. So welcome. Woo! Put your hand up.
Yeah, hey, let's go. I got my little tiny coffee cup out so I can kind of.
Oh my god, that is so tiny.
I got the pinky up.
Yeah, because you're fancy. Yeah.
That's right. Well, I'm so fancy that I stream out of my kitchen with a sign that says, "Hey, I'm a sexy fridge" right behind it.
And with you and Gail, a portrait of you and Gail.
Yeah, she did that. Isn't she a freaking, I don't want to shout out on your channel, but can we shout out Gail, please? That's some amazing art.
Can we get a shout out? I don't know if Bonnie knows how to spell it, so I'll do it.
Gail Hicks Weston.
I got it. Let me see. I want to make sure I get it right. Bonnie probably knows how to spell it, but Bonnie's a writer, by the way, and I'm a dipshit, so.
There you go. So am I. Let's just set the expectations for everybody else on the call that we're going to be the dipshits today.
Today we are the dipshits. Gail Hicks West, how are you, my love? Good to see you. I hope that you're doing well.
And oh, there she is.
I'm guessing that Gail is at work right now. So, Gail, yeah. Boom! Gail is probably at work. So, I won't blame Gail if she's not too chatty today. But if she wasn't at work, I would be like, why aren't you chatting more? No, I wouldn't be. That's not at all how we work here, everyone. Becca, thank you for that hug to Gail and love. Baron, you're from Texas. I read that in your bio. That's like about the only thing that I was able to read about you, because you have nothing about you online. It's literally, I had to watch your streams to know you even a little bit, which... I was telling you at the beginning, I was like, I completely respect that because of what social media is today and how time consuming and how much of a detriment that social media can be to people, mentally and you know, just on all kinds of levels, it can just be so detrimental. I'm just really curious, what prompted you to sort of take down all of your social medias? And I know you just recently put your IG back up, which you said I inspired you, which I'm sorry I inspired you to make a deal with the devil again. But you're welcome right. back. Welcome back to Satan's lair.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, that's a great topic, man. We could probably have a 2-hour conversation just about that. I guess I deleted Facebook a couple of years back and I have never really looked back since then.
Oh yeah, but fuck Facebook,
dude. It's just it's the best way I've ever heard it says is it's people's life highlight reel against your day-to-day life. And if you're, you know, pretty much every piece of social media that we do is just, it's going to inspire comparison. And yes. Comparison is kind of the thief of joy almost always.
Ooh,
so.
Look at this. We're off to the races, folks.
Yeah. Hey, I'm Baron. I sit in the kitchen and say things, man, you know.
Hey, Vince, I'm Baron. Yeah, no, I agree with you. And it's like one of those things that I'm really good at comparing myself to others, like always. And just in the recent few years, I've been doing a lot of work on myself, going to therapy, blah, 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 Abilify, blah, 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 whatever. You know, like it, that's definitely one of the things that I've sort of had to come to terms with is stop comparing yourself, stop trying to be something you're not, stop trying to project something you're not. And that's why, like, when it comes to posting, like, I try to do posts that it's not showing me in, like, you know, in these extravagant ways. And first of all, I'm not extravagant in any measure, but like, you know, it shows like a real side of who I am. And I just try to be real because like I feel like people just try to put their best foot forward. And like you said, what was that saying you said? It was you said it.
Comparison's the thief of joy.
Not that one. It was the one about.
Oh, it's people's highlight reel versus your everyday grind, basically.
Yeah, exactly. It's like it's not healthy. It's not healthy. But just in these past years, I've been able to sort of separate myself from that and sort of view it more as an entertainment platform than like, why is my friends doing this to me? You know, like, why is my friends enjoying their life at me? You know, like,
yeah.
Why are they doing this at me? You know, like,
I agree. Yeah.
So, but you know, that took me a long time to have that relationship with social media, which I'm not saying my relationship with social media is healthy in any matter of the, you know, but it is healthy in that way where I'm just like, it's not me going like, fuck that guy, he got that gig, and like, what are you doing? Fuck you. You know, it's not like that anymore. It's more like, oh, good for them and blah, blah, blah. And like, mostly it's business. So I don't know, what is it for you? We never really got to why you decided to sort of take that stuff down. And I know Facebook and stuff, but.
Well, it's an interesting tightrope to walk, I would say, especially if you're maybe like a creator in some kind of a way, which I am new to, right? But I, you know, you kind of want to have a mix of like, these are positive moments in my life. Cause like, if you use it for just sad, you know, you don't want to be the opposite side, which is I have friends that always post, and it's always tragedy. Like every day it's tragedy, tragedy, tragedy. Yeah. And that's kind of not super exciting either. Right. Because you don't want to spend your time reading through depressing news, and you don't want to spend your time reading through everybody's highlights that make you be like, yeah, you know, so it's, it is one to walk. I think, you know, moving away from it has allowed me to just spend a little bit more time focusing on what's important in my life. And if you can spend those 15 minutes getting a little bit better at animating South Park characters or something like that, then it was probably better than scrolling the gram, right?
Yeah, I guess. But let me just tell you something. Have you ever heard of TikTok? TikTok is incredible. And what's interesting for me about TikTok is that I'm keeping it kind of completely separate from like a friends platform. So what I mean by that is like where Instagram, I have like a bunch of my friends, I got family, you know, it's fans of the show, it's all this stuff. Whereas my We Speak English Good TikTok, I'm like friends with like a couple streamers and that's it. And like everyone else, all it is just news, conspiracy theories, fucking it's and it's like legit news. It's like people who are legit content creators working from their phone, giving legitimate news that you can actually go and research for yourself and look up. So it's become this really interesting platform where people are taking it a step further with conveying information. Now, a lot of that information is wrong or ridiculous, or it's just butts and boobies bouncing around and stuff. But it's like, but then there are some people out there like, you know, really doing some interesting stuff with the platform other than bouncing butts and boobies, which is nothing wrong with that. I mean, I love bouncing butts and boobies, but like it's, you know, there's more to life than just butts and boobies.
Yeah. You can get in some weird rat holes.
Oh,
on
yeah.
TikTok.
Oh yeah.
I don't really even have one. I'm like pushing off of making an account, but you know how it'll show you something and then it'll kind of let you keep going,
yes.
You know, and it keeps you going until you basically make an account.
Yeah.
it's been interesting to see. I guess my thought on that is, okay, it's the next iteration of the type of stuff that I thought wasn't good for me in the first place. So mm-hmm. maybe I shouldn't do it.
No, you're better off. TikTok. It's only worse. Yeah. It's only worse. Like worse as in better, but like, not great, you know, like that's not better for who, right? It's like,
right.
It's not but yeah, I think you're good on that. What do you think about like the things that are coming down the pipeline, like these things like I'm not sure if you follow this stuff at all, but like stuff like Neuralink and the metaverse, like when you're looking at those kind of things, do you pay attention to any of that stuff
or no? I don't. Is that like VR social media?
It is. Like, the metaverse is the next iteration of Facebook. I don't know if you've seen that, but it's really interesting, honestly. It's bringing up a lot of interesting topics in regards to, are you familiar with NFTs? I know your friend Gail is into it. So there's
I got one right here, man.
Is that an NFT?
I mean, I guess it's real media, so it can't be, but I wish it was an NFT.
You can. Yeah. You could totally Gail make Hicks. That. You could totally make that into a, you could definitely mint that and turn that into an NFT. No, it's really interesting stuff, honestly. I've been following this for a while, and then I saw a podcast actually with my friend Behind That Suit, and let's get another shout out for Behind That Suit. He's the one who I'm collaborating with. He was talking to somebody in regards to what they've been doing with NFTs and finding success in putting out new music. Now, are you considering making music? Are you considering putting out music? Because I didn't find any music of yours out there either.
Yeah, for sure. That's a good topic to get back into. And you know, I don't want to derail your NFT.
No. All be tied together. It's totally fine. We're weaving a conversation.
We're bobbing and weaving, right?
Yeah. Oh, we got it.
I box in my spare time, man. I was like trying to hide the nasty bruise, and I was like, I'm just gonna let it.
No.
Let it out.
Well, I'm glad you explained it, because then I would have been like, oh, he's a junkie.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not the most flattering, right?
Getting arm shots. Yeah. King K.
Hey. Well, yeah, and I mean, I think my story might be familiar to some on Twitch, especially new creators. And I have the utmost respect for people that have been doing this as a career to begin with. And I recognize myself as somebody who's new to the space. But I think it's, you know, I came into this. I had choir for most of my life. I've been a singer for a long time, and the pandemic really gave me an opportunity to explore this and discover this on Twitch. And the thing I keep saying to everybody is, hey, if you have a passion or something that you're interested in, you can find 5 friends that will support you in that on this platform. And that's super cool. I mean, there's no way in even 1990 or 2000 that somebody who basically didn't really know very much about playing guitar and didn't have too much in the ways of originals could come on and build a community and start making friends and networking and then set real goals and actually accomplish them in their hobbies. And it's not just music, right? It could be crocheting. It could be, you know, throwing rocks. I don't know. I've seen some weird Twitch streams, right?
Yeah.
But yeah, no, I think it's, we have this wonderful opportunity to grow in the things that we love here. And you have the added benefit of communities and friends along the way.
Yeah, I'm waiting for the throwing rock streamer. Like that's what I'm actually like, that's the one I'm waiting for. It's like, I want to, I actually think that would be interesting if someone was like super good at skipping stones. Like,
yeah,
that could be like, you know, lo-fi and skipping stones, you know, like let's just you know, pop, 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 pop. And like, and
have you heard it goes, whoop, 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 whoop.
Yeah.
When you get it really just right, it has that level.
Oh, yeah, it does, huh?
Yeah.
Oh, balls. Like, I kind of want to hear that. Let's hear the whistle.
Yeah, hell yeah, let's get it.
Skipping stones whistle.
I could put a little beatbox behind it if you like.
Of course. Hold on. Well, that's... Okay,
it actually kind of sounds like a beat already, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. Look, I got my ad remover is fucking in the way. Awesome. Get out of here, fuckface. Okay, that's on frozen ground though. Like I want. Oh my god. Can we just okay, what is happening here? I'm trying to install an ad blocker, and it's just, someone told me the last time, I was like, what happened to your ad blocker, stupid? And I'm just like, oh yeah, I forgot. And then so here I am. Okay. Awesome story, Mike. Little.
I love traveling and seeing people. Maybe that is the reason.
Can I just get some sound? I think, is it only on frozen lakes that they make that sound?
I think it must. Well, oh, okay. I think that's the video. The guy freaks out.
That is so bizarre.
Yeah, this is it.
Let's where's the guy freaking out? Whoa.
It's cool, right?
That sounds like some synth stuff. It does. It sounds like some modular synth shit.
Yeah, it does. This is going to be a throwback one. Oh, I'll listen.
Oh, no, go ahead. What's the throwback one?
I think it was like in 2013 or so, there's a trance artist called BT, and he did that song called Skylarking. You might recognize the melody if you don't know the song, but he was in the forest in Costa Rica, and he was listening to the birds go, chip, 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 and he's just like, I'm going to put that on my keyboard and turn that into a song.
Oh, sweet. Who did that? It's
BT, Skylarking.
Oh God, I suck. I just keep on sucking. BT Skylarking.
Well, I didn't realize you must be West Coast then, right?
I'm actually East Coast.
Oh, you're East Coast. Okay.
Yeah, I'm in Ohio.
Oh, okay, cool, man. Cool. Yes. Or at least I wasn't, you know, waking you up 3 hours before the time that
No, I changed my time on you, bro. The irony of the ad remover being the ad that needs remove. Look at how engaging Throid Rox is. Turns out it's totally the thing to do. It is. I mean, especially when it has like really cool sounds on it. All right, give me what I want. Wait.
Yeah, you may want to skip like 30 seconds in, maybe.
Oh, this is. Wait.
Is it?
Oh, that was it? And it.
Yeah. There's a part in the chorus where it goes doot 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 doot. It's like meant to resemble birds. Yeah, this part.
DCMA, come and get me.
There's a little descant in just a second.
Well, now we're here. We're here. We're doing it, Baron.
Okay, all right, let's do it.
Here we go. It's the rise, y'all. It's the rise. All right, well, so that was inspired by birds and stuff like that.
Yeah, bird song. Yeah, for sure.
That's dope. Well, I love that. I love that kind of stuff, man. I love it when people sort of take those, I don't know, like those found samples and turn it into something cool. You see that a lot with these lo-fi fuckers who are out there just sampling, you know, them beating on their dryer and shit. It's like, how dare you? Dare you go out and craft sounds from IRL? I was expecting toucan call. Listen, Bonnie, you can't. You get what you get and you don't throw a fit, all right? All right? I was expecting like a whole crazy beep, 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 but I heard what he was talking about with how they were sort of doing that. I'd love to see him sample it. Like I'd love to see like a making of that.
Yeah.
Do they have a make? No.
I don't know. Yeah, I was listening to Armin van Buuren's trance show and he brought him on there and he was like, yeah. He's like, yeah, mate, I was hanging out in Costa Rica and I heard some birds and I put in my song.
Well, that's the way to do it. Some friends of the show and friends in real life, they're called the Heavy Color. They're here in Ohio, and their second album was really interesting because they worked with this company and they flew out to Africa. And of course, I forgot what part of Africa. I mean, Africa is a huge, huge place. So somewhere, and They met some people and they're recording sounds there and they're recording chants. And what they ended up doing is they ended up meeting other producers there and they ended up sending their hard drives back and forth through the mail because this is the only way they could do it. For whatever reason, they couldn't figure out Google Drive or whatever. So they were like literally sending hard drives through the mail and they would do some stuff and send it back. Actually, this I'm gonna look it up because you can actually hear. Do you work in any of those capacities when you're looking at your music when you finally do pull it out on album? Are you looking to do something in that capacity, or what's your method that you're gonna be going?
Where I have to like take my hard drive out of my PC and send it to somebody?
No. I'm sorry. No, but are you looking at Found Sound as a part of your sound, or are you gonna go pretty straightforward with your how you're gonna be recording your album?
Sure. Sure. Yeah. No, I think I think it's just going to be basic, you know, sad days in Ableton is probably what it's going to be. You know, I actually got my start and I still swear by this program when I was like 16. I downloaded Audacity and I still think it's like got to be the best one ever made.
It's
like,
amazing.
It's just so easy.
Yeah, it's amazing. It really is. I agree with you completely.
So, I think.
Sorry.
Oh, go ahead.
No. I was just being this. Okay, please finish what you were saying.
Yeah. No, I was just gonna say. I think it's it is certainly a goal for 2022. Mm-hmm. I just I'm looking for a few different elements, but I think we're due for a revival in the sort of like Coldplay, Keane-esque British maybe piano and nice soft voice sounding pop.
Yeah.
So if there has been a band that's come out like that lately, I haven't seen them. So I'm gonna try to make a very amateur effort of emulating and kind of into that groove.
Sweet. Sure. So you're gonna be recording your own album. You're gonna be doing your own. Oh, sweet. And do you have experience in that at all? Like in the past?
Not really, man, to be honest with you, other than just like silly, we probably made a silly track every single day in college in Audacity.
That's amazing, though.
There's some vaults of the freestyle raps of Bear in the Bar. They're never going to see the light of day.
No, we have to hear it. Oh, my God. We need the raps. We need the raps. Why can't we have the raps? Baron, you cannot hold the world. You can't hold the world like this by the balls. You gotta like release this so we can all enjoy the Baron rapper. What'd you go by? Can I know your rap name at least?
No, I don't think I had one. I think it was just Baron. The closest you can hear to it is my my raid sound effect. I took Mike Shinoda. You know he's like 20% talent, 30% this. And I made a little riff on that, and I just kind of, like, I have a little, like, it's like a little 10-second raid message. So that's the closest you can find.
I got you. Maybe I got something for you. Hold on. We're going to go over here. Fresh. This is Baron rapping. I found the video, guys. I found it.
I'm not the typical rapper that you'll meet. I'm don't live in a box, nor was I raised on the street. And as you can see, I'm not black. I don't do drugs, and I'm not on crack.
There you go, guys. I found Barron's.
Can't believe you found. How did you find that, man?
I mean, I'm quick. I'm quick with it. I'm my own young Jamie, is what I'm saying.
That's right. Do you remember 50 Tyson also?
50 Tyson? That, no.
That guy was a legend. It's just like a really bad freestyle rap. 50 Tyson. You got to listen to 50 Tyson.
Yeah, well, that's what we're doing, folks. We're listening to 50 Tyson. Oh, my God. What's going on?
Oh, my God. Oh, that's Mike Tyson.
50 Tyson rapper. There we go. Oh, shit. Watch out. 50 Tyson, watch out. 2009.
Hey, this your boy 50 Tyson. Nah, same, but it's like, man, hit me up, though. My album is coming out in stores pretty soon. Go get it up. And then it's going to be popping, though. Nah, I'm saying. But
is this the actual rap?
See,
I don't
man,
know.
Yeah,
hold
yeah.
On. Yeah, here we go.
But hold on one second. Before I do it, though,
he feels
what
like...
you make, this is my last video I'm going to make out for right now. But here we go. Yeah, yeah. You might see me all blue, all red, every day, every day. I'm 50 Tyson. I'm from Northside Zone, Twin City, Minnesota. That's where I'm from. And I've been back. I put it on for my city like it ain't nothing. So we get the same. They call me 50 Tyson. I'm from the Northside Zone, Twin City, Minnesota.
Well, we're canceled.
That's basically all you need.
We're
That's
canceled
me.
Now, though. Yeah. Now you're canceled, okay.
Yeah.
hold on. We need more than that. Like I need something. I need something. This was uploaded 12 years ago. Yeah.
I think it's like an old Vine, man.
Hey, this your boy 50 Tyson, man. I'm back now. No, I'm saying
he's back. He's back.
Chapter S like brother. I love pressure. I should be a punter. I just life, like haters when they say me worth it. I start living life because they live it once. That's why I'm up in church more than a blessed night. Just call me 50 Cent or Spider-Man. I'm still sharpening at like Target. I got Julius, man. I live life smart. This here costs a Bible. I live in an area where I'm in the era people of Bible. If the parents teach you, all kids learning, it's thy troop or die, or we'll still turn it. I saw.
I got that one. He got a rhyme in there.
Yeah, there was something that happened there.
You got a place where the earth gets spinning.
Hey, he's from Ohio too, didn't he? Oh no, Twin City, Minnesota.
Minnesota is not Ohio. I take offense
you might,
to that.
That's close. Man, that's close. You could have him on the show in person. Invite him over.
I won't, but I mean, maybe I would. I mean, I wouldn't. I mean, honestly, I wouldn't mind having him. It was not like it would be terrible, but I mean, like, I almost feel bad because like you can kind of see in his face that he might have maybe like a learning disability or something, you know, like, so I kind of feel bad for laughing at him, but or he could just be like just a terrible rapper. But
yeah, you never know.
I'm not trying to call him anything. I'm just saying you can see that there's something clearly missing behind those eyes there. And hey, more power to him. He has 13,000 subscribers on YouTube, so he got a little money for this. So whatever.
I was gonna say, you know, he's doing better than my Twitch career. So put it that way.
Yeah. I mean, he's monetized and he hasn't released anything in 12 years. So
yeah,
I haven't. Yeah. I can't even get monetized on YouTube. So for your album, are you thinking, are you going to be releasing it onto like the music streaming platforms like Spotify, or are you thinking you're going to go on more the indie side of indie and like stick to like SoundCloud and
SoundCloud
stuff?
SoundCloud, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I don't really know the politics behind the choice. I don't really take myself seriously enough to maybe release it on a paid platform.
I feel you.
I think, and I'm new to the game, man, like I said. So I think at this stage, just getting your music out there is probably the best thought. What do you think?
Yeah, I honestly think that's the truth. You got to start somewhere, and a lot of people set themselves up for failure by trying to get it perfect. Or like, I can't release this album until it's perfect. I can't do it like this. or I can't release this until I have all my ducks in line and like I got my gigs and all lined up and like this is going to be a huge launch and stuff. It's like, if you're new to this and you don't know how this works all that much, it's like, first of all, just start learning and start releasing stuff and see how things do, because you're never going to know if people like your stuff if people never hear your stuff. So
yeah, right.
and even if it's like you're new at this, and even if you don't think that you're the best, it's okay. It's okay to fail online. It's okay to see a growth pattern. You know what I mean? Because like, there's stuff online that I do that I've done like 12 or 15 years ago that are just like, what in the fuck is that? And it's just out there living its life. You know, I don't even remember how to like sign in to take that shit off now. You know, like that's just on there. So, you know, but that's okay. That's okay, because you have a lineage of progress. And as you start releasing, and as you get better at Ableton, and as you get more familiar with your tools that you have, your voice, your guitar, your instruments, your DAWs, it's gonna grow. You're gonna get better. And if you stay consistent and you stay moving with it, then you're gonna go somewhere with it. It just depends on how far you want to take it. So yeah, absolutely. I think that's the best thing to do, is just start releasing it. And if you're not sure about paying to release it, then SoundCloud is a wonderful option. Wise words. Thank you, Snarf. I appreciate it.
I know. I was like, man, you totally got Twitch chat saying nice things too. That was really well said.
Well, I've been doing this for a while. this is all like pre-programmed rhetoric at this point.
Right.
I just regurgitate the stuff that just lives in me. I have enormous anxiety over my stuff and how to roll it out. Well, I mean, again, it's just where you're at in your career. Now, if you're someone who's like a big streamer that you really like, Baron, who releases music. Oh, who is that?
It's Shanee Rose.
Oh, okay, yeah. So someone like her who's been doing this for years, right? Like, she had a career before Twitch. You know what I mean? She's been working on her music before Twitch. She's been, I guarantee if you go onto her YouTube, if she hasn't taken them down, but most really good artists have some like YouTube video from like 12, 15 years ago where it's just them in their room sounding like shit. Okay. So like, that's the fun thing about this. You got to understand, is like, people come into this at all different stages of their career. And so again, we're going to kind of go back to comparison is the thief of joy. If you're sitting there comparing yourself to someone like Shanee, is that how you say it?
Shanee Rose.
Shanee Rose. I can never say her name. If you compare yourself to someone like that, who's been doing this for, you know, most of her life, who's been releasing music for their whole life, you're going to feel like shit. But if you look at it, but if you can just step back and realize that she started somewhere in the same level as you at some point in their career, it gives you a little bit more of a perspective. It's like, you know, it's just something to build on. You're just building on this. And music is a lifelong pursuit. So it's not like you're going anywhere. You know, like what's the hurry? What, you know, like you already seem like you're content with what you're doing in your own life. And this is just something that you're doing because you enjoy it. And it's just another chance to sort of relive a dream that you might have thought. I mean, am I right? Did you at one point want to be a musician and decide to walk away from it?
Yeah, well, I think you make a lot of really good points. And it does come down to what the ultimate goal of it is, right? Mm-hmm. That's a really great thing that I guess you have to think through. I always felt like, so I did like, you know, the choir competitions and stuff like that. And if I'm being totally honest, I feel like I was always like one level below. Like, I'd get to like the region choir level or like the area choir level. I wouldn't get to the all-state one, right? And so I was always just kind of like one level below. I'll get like the lead supporting role in a musical and not like the actual lead role in a musical. And in ways that's been good, because that allowed me to kind of, you know, go to school and pursue a career in business and get into technology and software, which I love today. Mm. But, you know, at least I had that kind of clarity from you know, when I was younger that I had a gap there. Now, like you said, that can also be limiting to you if you're thinking, well, I'm trying to compare myself to those A kids, those like, you know, the people who were always the top of the choir or the top of the musical theater. And, you know, how can I compare? So it takes a little while, maybe some age and some growth and personal development to have the confidence to come out and say, well, you know, I may be at a different starting point, but I'm going to start and I'm going to improve. And sometimes that improvement is really the goal for me that I just love to see over time, you know?
Yeah. I mean, that's the beautiful thing about being a musician is that these small little increments of growth are so motivating, right? Like, because like I couldn't do this, whatever, I couldn't make this chord structure a month ago, but now I'm hitting it. Like, it ain't shit, man. Like, what, you know, like this crazy inverted, you know, /7/11 chord is just like, it's easy now because, you know, you've ran it so many times. It's just like, yeah, man, you just build. It's a building process. You're building foundations, and again, it's where do you want to take it? Is like, are you looking for bright shiny lights, fame, and touring, or are you looking just to like be someone who's just having a good time and they're looking to expand on their hobby? You know, it's both are okay. It's like both is okay pursuits. SoundCloud is good for monetizing, you say? Would be very interesting to talk about it more. Listen, SoundCloud, you can monetize. They just started monetizing on SoundCloud. So, yes, SoundCloud is an option to where you can make money now. Let's look into it a little bit more. Unfortunately, they're assholes and they don't... So SoundCloud hosts my... SoundCloud hosts my podcast, but they don't offer okay. Jeez, oh, Pete's. I just put monetizing. Where is it? So monetize your tracks. So yes. So SoundCloud is a way for you to upload your stuff. Low key. What's up? Low key, you good to see you. Thank you for stopping in. Popped in to look who's here, and it's
hey, the Bard himself. What's going on?
Yes, it is. Yes, I enjoyed your stream, Loki. It was so nice to like hang out in your stream. I forget how like calming and how nice and charming you're. You're a proper wench. I forgot how charming and fun your stream can be, and your community is so nice and lovely. So it was very nice to see you over the weekend. I think it was over the weekend. Sorry, I've been super high this entire weekend. So it might have been 2 weekends ago. Who fucking knows? Okay, so here is the details. So they're monetizing through a third-party system through Symphonic, which you might want to look into Symphonic. I think they also offer sync placement, but don't quote me on that. And sync placement, if you don't know, sync placement is how people get placement in ads. So Sync is an actual company where you can upload your music to, and it's just basically a bank that you store your music, and people come and they look through your stuff. If they like it, they'll take it, and they pay you about $15 per track, which is much more than you're going to get probably in the lifetime of your track on Spotify if you're not promoting and marketing, if you're not spending thousands of dollars marketing your song. So it's actually another cool way to get paid for your music. But here in SoundCloud, they just started offering it. So you must, so like YouTube, you must have 1,000 followers on your profile whilst through Symphonic. So you have to sign up through Symphonic to get this. Monetization of your main label or artist profiles. I don't know what that means. No additional sign-up fee. You earn 70% of all royalties. So they do take a cut of your royalties. Ability to monetize multiple profiles under your account. So if you have different song, if you have different artist names, or if you have different artists under your label, you know, or if you go by different artists, or if you have different bands, you can also set up different accounts, different artist accounts, all under one account, so they all monetize and all the money goes in one place. Distribution into SoundCloud Go platform, which Go platform is their latest iteration of a paid. It's like Apple Music. So like you pay for it and you don't have to see the ads. Spotify, you pay for it, so they remove the ads. YouTube Premium, you pay for it. So SoundCloud Go, adless listening. Pre-clearance of tracks with help of our support staff. I'm not sure what that means. Monthly statements and payments. So basically analytics. Essential monetization facts. Users hear ads while playing your music on mobile or more. White listing, no copyright issues preventing you to upload. Pre-clearance ensures your publishing is properly set up. So it's looking like if you go through Symphonic, you're going to have to Yes. That is a decent goal, and it's reachable. It's an attainable goal, too. One thing you can do in regards to reaching that is how I reached it on my YouTube goal, because I got 1,000 followers or subs, was there is sub for sub, follow for follow groups you can find on things like Facebook, which I know is awful. But you can find they're very useful. Like people when I first started, when the pandemic first started, and I was like, oh shit, all my gigs are gone. Now I have to figure out how to monetize my life again. A charming wench. You're always very welcome and always very good to see you. Thank you very much, Loki. Much love to you. And by the way, everybody, I'm so sorry I didn't tell you guys. My brain is finally warming up here. If you guys have an question for Baron, the channel points, it's very affordable just by being here. It's one fresh bar to ask a question. So if you do have a question for Baron or for me, oh my God, who subscribed? Baron the Bard. Oh, Baron. How dare you do that, Baron? You're my guest. Stop wasting it. Oh, he's paying it for it. Yeah. Stop every. Would you rather? Okay, we'll do that as well. Let's get through these monetizing, because part of this show we do talk about a lot of different things that make up a musician's life, but part of a musician's life is figuring out how to live by being a musician. So I think this is a very important thing to go over, especially as Baron, you yourself are looking to release music, and this is an option for you. So yeah. I'm just going through this for you guys. This is for you. And Snarf Music, are you a streamer? If so, why aren't I following you? And why the fudge am I fudging not talking to you? Oh, you do stream.
The language got more PC, Mike. What's going on? It's like the brain warmed up and we're going to start censoring ourselves, huh?
Yeah, well, you know, as soon as I start thinking clearly, censorship makes way more sense. Thank you for that shout out, Bon Bon. So we will ensure your track stays online during clearance. So I'm guessing clearance has to do with the making sure that you're not stealing, or it's not, you know, you're not, they have to make sure everything. Thanks so much for going over this. I had no idea you can monetize on SoundCloud. Yeah, I know, right? Isn't that cool? You can apply through Symphonic Dashboard by clicking right. So here you go, guys. I'm going to go ahead and drop this into the chat so you guys can check this out for yourself. And if you do have music currently on SoundCloud, go and click on that link and read through this for yourself, because this is a really, it's really useful. Oh, look at this, they got a video. It's only a minute 25, let's look.
How to use the SoundCloud monetization service. Our SoundCloud monetization service allows you to enable demonetization for tracks that you have manually uploaded to your SoundCloud profile. Let's dive into the process. If you have already applied for our SoundCloud monetization service and have received an acceptance message from our team, then you will be able to start enabling monetization on your SoundCloud tracks. You will just need to go to the track you want to monetize, click on the edit icon, choose the monetization tab for the track, enable monetization, enter all the metadata pertaining to the track. Keep in mind that both artist name and ISRC are mandatory. If you don't have an ISRC for that track, please contact our support team. Save your changes, and that's it. If you want to check if the track is monetizing correctly, go back into edit mode and look at the territories. If Symphonic Distribution is showing under the monetizable territories, then you are all set. Have any questions? Shoot us a message and ask away.
There you go. And if you guys are interested in YouTube monetization, the specs are 1,000 subscribers. You have to have over 4,000 watch hours. Why is that over there? Why is everything ruining? Delta Crab, thank you so much for that follow. I had to move.
What's up, DC?
DC, welcome in. Thank you so much for that follow. We're just going over monetizing on SoundCloud because our dear friend Baron is looking into releasing music sometime here near the future. So, yeah. So we got a would you rather for the guests, which is filthy would you rather. which is just a game. I don't know if you guys know the game, but it's a but it's a filthy one. It's the filthy edition because why the fuck not? Oh, there you go. There you go, Baron. I'm back. I'm back. The fucks are back. That's why this channel's, you know what? I really wrestled for a long time on whether or not I should have a mature. Oh, who was that? What just happened? Why am I missing everything? Oh, Destiny, thank you so much for being here. DG and DC, welcome.
Hey. Mike, real quick before we get into the naughty would you rather, can I give some love to Delta Crab?
I would love. please so feel free to interact with the chat as much as you want, Baron.
For sure, for sure. Yeah, so we're both New England area streamers, and we had a little Baron the Bard holiday spectacular event on Friday, and I had the absolute pleasure of having Delta.
Was that who was sitting in with you on the mandolin?
Yeah.
Oh, dude, that was so rad. I watched a lot of that. Oh, dude, following you, Delta Crab, New England streamer here. Let's go be nosy. Oh, you can see what I'm doing. Never mind. We're being nosy. Let's find out about Delta a little bit. Everybody go follow Delta. Delta is a fantastic streamer, and I only saw him with Baron. So Taiwanese-American, Massachusetts, singer, songwriter, producer, covers, remixes, live loops, live learns, bass, guitar, keys, drums, aerophone, mandolin, rock, pop, folk, country, R&B, funk, soul, blues, hip-hop, VGM, Cookie Fitness, Pixel Art, Hot Top, bitch, let's motherfucking go!
That was hype as hell. I'm here for it.
That was the hypest. Now I got but please, yeah. What did you want to say about him?
Just that he's awesome. Great guy on and off stream. And he came to do an acoustic set with me, but really awesome looper. Really absolute fire bassist. If you ever want to hear some badass bass guitar, check out Delta. But the person that we rated, Mike, it was Destiny, and she's here too. So basically you got the whole Bard holiday party hanging out right
Who's
now.
Who's Destiny? Oh, Destiny!
Destiny Gira, voice of gold. Destiny Gira.
We're gonna start with Delta Crab. Delta Crab, I'm guessing that I'm gonna want you on this show as well. So just be prepared to receive an invite. I'm thinking of how you live it wrong. Shit. Let's go. That's some funky crab right there, baby. Yes. Sex Laws by Beck. What a fucking awesome cover to do. I love that album that's on too. That's like what album is that? It's the one that's after. Yeah, fuck, I can't remember. Whatever. Delta is excellent. Well, now we have to go and look at Destiny.
Yes, do that.
Let's go look at Destiny, the voice of an angel.
Voice of gold.
Voice of gold.
We were sitting around thinking about what we wanted to call her voice when Crab was over here. We came up with platinum and gold, and we called it Platigold.
Platigold. We're showing platitude for Platigold.
If I were a rich man, I'd have a voice like that. Platigold, baby. Let's go,
Platigold. All right, let's see if we can find a highlight of something. Maybe they have a highlight of one of their own songs. All videos? No, it's just all streams. Okay, well then we're just gonna jump into a stream.
Just jump in, man.
We're just gonna jump in.
Amazing singer.
Mr. Pink, yes. I did. I'm going to do an unboxing.
Ooh, we got sounds. Hold on. Here we go. Yeah. Platigold. Yeah.
last Christmas, gave you my heart. The very next day you gave it away. This year,
listen to that plaid of gold.
Plaid of gold. Give it to someone special.
Last Christmas, gave you my heart. The very next day you gave it away.
Damn.
This year, to save me from tears, give it to someone special.
Very nice.
Oh, very nice, DG. Yeah, I like to give Destiny a hard time and tell her that her glasses came out of the Twizzler factory. But you know what she said back? She goes, I'm worried because these glasses have become such a part of my identity and who I am that like I take them off and I'm like, who's this person in the mirror?
Out in the street, they call it murder.
Hey.
Oh man. Well, I understand that. I understand that. Those glasses are very bold. Those are a very bold statement. And I honestly now I want to see what she looks like without the glasses. Like we're gonna be nosy and go look around a little.
I think it's hard to find. You can get her to change glasses on stream if you like do a channel points or something like that, but
oh, she'll change glass. Oh, not that hard. But we don't have a full face. Where's the full face? We need a full face without the glasses.
Destiny, are you appreciating like your FBI probe that we're doing to you right now?
Isn't this wonderful?
Yeah.
This isn't awkward for you, I'm sure. Oh, Lord. We're going to find something. And we found one thing, but we didn't find... Oh. Look at this. Look at that.
Beautiful.
Look at those big, look at those gorgeous eyes. My God.
Beautiful lady. Yep. 100%.
Holy cow, you got beautiful eyes. Well, Destiny, welcome. Thank you for being here. And I'm following you now. And I'll probably end up asking you on the show if you're interested.
I'll set the bar low, guys, so it's easy to look really good.
And I want to go follow. I want to go follow Delta Crab as well because why the freak not? Why the freak not, brah? Oh man, I didn't look. This welcome everybody to me subscribing and following people on Twitch.
I know that song.
Hold on. I'm going over YouTube. Oh my gosh. Okay, I see. So she's murdering it on YouTube. So there you go.
Yeah.
This is what I also do to people. It's like I also like to go look how many people are their patrons. Damn! $95 a month. Shit. There you go. That's a nice little check to get everybody. Yeah, I know that's awkward and tacky. I know it is. I don't care. This is what I do, son. I research musicians and artists, okay? This is how I make content. All right, guys. Let's get back to our main hero of the day here, Baron the Bard. So, Baron, we have Would You Rathers and questions from the chat. So,
how dare I try
to skip over that? We'll come back to releases and we'll come back to what Baron does because he said something about being in the tech industry. So,
for sure,
I'm interested. Oh yeah, baby. All right, so let's find a good Would You Rather. I might have to open the other side because we've definitely ran up in these guts way too many times. So hold on. Oh, here we go. She opened the other side, so I don't feel bad.
Crab Lab, baby, Crab Lab.
Yeah, do your thing, Crab. Thank you so much for being here and enjoy your lurk, enjoy your lunch. I hope that you enjoy the rest of the whatever we're doing here. All right, we got brand new cards, folks. Brand new.
I'm ready. Hit me with it.
Would you rather have your partner use baby talk in bed or have your partner use drill sergeant talk in bed?
Oh, baby talk, easy.
Why not drill sergeant?
It wouldn't be my style to be addressed in such a way. That's all I have to say about that.
Get down and give me head now, soldier.
Yeah, I know. I feel like if anything, I'm usually the drill sergeant. That's like my, you know, my part-time gig.
Oh, really? You're the dom?
I have to be, man. It's hard to make money out here on these cold Boston streets.
I gotta get out there, dominate some motherfuckers.
Yeah, that's right.
So you know, before we move on to what you're doing, I kind of wanted to cover this really quick. We did see the bruises. We did see the bruises. Yes, we did. We did see the bruises. That was
I can give you a little flex if that's what you
need
for me.
There it is. Let's go. There it is. Gun show. Gun show. So yeah, there's people are always looking for different ways to monetize their music. People are looking for different ways to release their music. And one of the really cool ways that I've been seeing as of late, and especially with the explosion of NFTs, is people releasing music as NFTs, releasing art as NFTs. Beeple, are you familiar with Beeple at all? He's a digital artist. He's pretty amazing, actually. Excuse me, Destiny. Destiny, be expecting an invite onto this show, just so you know. I will be reaching out. You can ignore me, which is fine. I totally get it. Or you can say no. Wow, why did I make it weird and awkward? That's great, Mike. Real nice, Mike. Real nice. I guess you can ignore me if you want. Whatever.
It's like a little Beavis and Butthead vibes, man. I love it.
Well, I'm trying to find a way to search.
I promise Destiny's a lovely human and she'll be happy to hear from you.
I'm sure she is a wonderful person, and even if she doesn't want to come on, I'm sure she's a wonderful human being. Look, not everybody, and here's the other thing, not everybody wants to come on and talk about themselves like this, so I don't take it personal anymore when people are like, I'm good.
I'm just really into Baron, you know what I mean?
Exactly. It's
how
like,
can I talk about myself today, you know?
what the hell was I just looking up?
I don't know. Oh, you're talking about NFT. So we could get a Destiny song as an NFT. Like you get copy number one of 1,000 of a song or something, right?
Right. It's
like
right.
With the label, this is number one or
exactly.
Whatever,
right? Well, yeah. I was looking up something on I was looking up Beeple crap. God damn it. This is how we never get anywhere on this show. It's like I'll get sidetracked and look up Beeple. So like this is what he does. He does like crazy weird things. Like here's Donald Trump with a hamburger between his head and you know, it's just very nice. Awkward thing.
McDonald's advertising.
Yeah, exactly. You know, just really weird. Like this is probably his really popular one. This Kim Jong-un or whatever one is pretty popular amongst his followers. So it's just really off-putting. It can be funny and stuff, but he just made like $100 million off of his own NFTs that he made out of his own digital art. So, yeah, exactly. So this is what people are doing right now. Oh, the ad blockers are working.
Nice.
Yeah, right? Finally, it paid off. So I wanted to kind of get through this. So what unites electronic producers, 3LAU, Steve Aoki with Nashville Rockers, Kings of Leon, and alternative artist Grimes? No, it's not mind-bending collaborative singles. Stupid fucking articles. Instead, together they've each earned millions in recent months by selling non-fungible tokens paid for in online cryptocurrency. This has sparked media and music industry buzz, but for many outside the bubble, these terms still feel alien. Let's get past. We know what non-fungible tokens mean. So it, basically, it just means that you can't alter them. They're not. You can't. Let's look what it says actually. In fact, non-fungible simply means unique. So it's not takeable. It's completely unique. You can't. There's no. You can make copies of it, but there's no. There's only one of it. And it's stored on the blockchain, which, you know, people are probably like, I don't know what you're talking about, but that's okay. You're familiar with this stuff then, right?
Yeah, for sure. for sure. I don't know if I would actually be a buyer ever of any of it. But
do you think it's
a
Ponzi? Do you think it's a big Ponzi scheme?
I don't know about a scheme, but it's just like, you know, I would struggle to find, you know, if some of these things are selling more than like, you know, Mike Tyson autograph gloves or mm-hmm. like who's your favorite quarterback autograph jersey that he won the Super Bowl in, you know, and yeah. it's like, and it's really just a silly, you know, it's just not, it's in a bubble of value right now. I don't think it's fake, but I think it needs to come down to like, well, that was probably worth $25, not 10,000 before right. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, it's interesting because when you look down here, let's just read this whole thing. If the concept may be odd right now, the financial bottom line is clear. There's potentially a lot of money to be made right now. Grimes sold almost $6 million in NFTs in just 20 minutes. Steve Aoki sold a collection for about $4.25 million. Kings of Leon sold a batch for about $2 million. 3LAU sold for about almost $12 million. So, you know, whatever the thought is now, right now people are making money, and this is an interesting way of sort of going forward and creating this new way of distributing music and monetizing it. And I just find it completely fascinating. And Mighty Mighty, thank you so much for gifting We Are Mellotone. I appreciate that. And Mighty Mighty. Hope you're doing well, Mighty.
She's a brick house, baby. Let's go.
She is a brick house. I hope you're doing well and welcome, and thank you so much for your love. That's all the love you give to this. So, yeah, I just wanted to sort of bring this up. So there's tons of people out there doing it. Paul McCartney, Kate Bush, you know, like people are. And look, fucking Linkin Park, Mike Shinoda, right here. Prior to the pandemic, artists had increasingly relied on touring to break even. But with live music continuing to face an uncertain future, the potential of NFTs to supplement income holds a huge appeal. This is especially true because it offers artists a chance to bypass the swath of label, which is sort of like Spotify. These days, or even SoundCloud, that those could be kind of considered labels in a way, because they do take a portion of your money to distribute distribute Surely. Music yep. and your streams, distributor and publisher rights. So basically, it puts all the power back in your hands, where you're getting all the money from it, and anyone who invests in it also gets to make money as well. So not only are you making money, but anybody who buys into your product, into your piece of digital art, or your music, your song, they're also making money off of it as well. So you're creating an interesting community where, like, through your art, you're able to sort of bring up your fans with you. So I think that's extremely, extremely interesting to way of sort of building community around art. So cool to me. Linkin Park co-founder Mike Shinoda reflected this in a series of tweets after receiving $10,000, a $10,000 bid for one of his NFTs. Even if I upload the full version of the contained song to DSPs worldwide, he tweeted, I would never get close to $10,000 after fees by DSPs label marketing. So yeah, I'm not sure what DSPs stand for, but let's look that up.
Distributors.
Yeah. Distributor. Oh yes, yes.
Distribution partner, probably.
Yes, exactly. So yeah. So what I was just saying is, like, you're cutting out the middleman, which is what Spotify and streaming and Napster and all those things were sort of leading the way in, until the record companies actually now own huge big pieces of these companies, and it's basically. Yeah, they're basically running the same game on us again. Basically, they're back at the gatekeepers. Now they're the ones who, like, sort of control these playlists, and you know, you have to pay them to get your songs on playlists. You got to pay them to market on Spotify or any of these different things. So it's sort of, you know, and meanwhile, all these streams, you could have 1 million streams and get like $10 for 1 million plays on your song. So it's a very skewed system, and it's skewed very much against us. And I think sort of with the idea of decentralized currency and sort of decentralizing art in this way, I think we're finding an even straighter path from artists to fan. You know what I mean? And without all these different mitigators. I don't know. What are your thoughts on this?
Yeah, that's a really interesting one. And I'm gonna answer that question, and then I'm gonna get a refill on my coffee, so I'll need a 30-second break after I answer this. But it's very interesting if you think about the history of business, right? Somebody in like 1904 or whatever came up with the idea that people could own little pieces of businesses, and that's how we have the modern stock market. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, they were able to kind of segue that into, well, can you own a piece of a weather outcome? Can you own a piece of a climate, or a, you know, is the, you know, what time is the sun going to set today? Can I make an instrument? And now it's effectively going from the broad, you know, sort of meta business community into how can you own a piece of Bear and the Bard, right?
Yeah.
And I think it's a positive because of the incredible, you know, like you said, the reduction of the power of labels and other people to interfere with our producer and fan. I think the negative is, like, we've seen how crazy things can be with the stock market and how people can invest and lose it. Mm-hmm. I have to imagine there would be even less controls on something like this. Like, if you put $50,000 into one piece of Bear and the Bard, and then tomorrow it was worth $50, like, I would actually feel bad because I feel like you we were in this together, and now you're screwed. And, like, meanwhile, I got the $50,000 and...
But on the other side of that, they're investing in your art, and they enjoy your art. And so, like, at the end of the day, they still have the art, and obviously they were trying to make money. But I mean, this is just the nature of the beast. Someone kind of brought up that same point the other day, where it's like, well, why would I invest all this money into minting and doing all this stuff, and it might not even work out? And to that I say, that's the business, baby. That's music. Like, you'll invest fucking $20,000 into an album that three people will hear. That happens every day, all the time. So I'm sorry. Like, fuck, I don't see too much of a downside onto this, even because we all – I mean, it's the same thing also if you are finding investors for your album, you know, outside of labels or even with labels. If you're signed with a major label and they invest $50,000 into your album, guess what? You're on the line for that $50,000, whether people buy that album or not. So after you're done and your label drops you, you're still on the line for $50,000. That follows you until death. Mm. And so I don't see much of a difference. I think the risk and reward is more on the side of the artist here than anything else really out there. But again, you're right. Like, it is a weird system. I mean, as we saw Bitcoin and all these, like, Dogecoin, like these stock memes, you know, these meme stocks sort of
stonks. I love stonks.
Me too. Like, stonks.
I love the stonks guy.
You gotta love the stonks.
And it's interesting too. I mean, you can make a metaphor here to, like, the housing market, right? Mm. So historically, it was illegal or very frowned upon legally for companies to buy single family homes and speculate and become an investor layer on top of the single family home, because that was, you know, like, the American dream was to buy a home. And if you have people bidding up your home from $200,000 to $2 million, it's not good for the people, right?
No.
But now that's kind of like, well, they're like, well, we democratized it. Now you can invest in homes and you have this whole layer, right?
Yeah.
So it's, you know, it's just the same thing. I think it starts with good intentions. Like, if you buy a house and you want to live there and you want to love it, that's great. It's once all that investor money comes in and you start doing a roller coaster of, like, oh no, my bear, my nudie Baron photo was worth $1 million yesterday, and now it's worth $5. You know, like, it's never been worth more than $5 to begin with, if we're being honest with each other. But
right. Well, I mean, all of this is just made up. I mean, like, but the way that our money system works out now, I mean, that's the same thing. It's just a collective belief that these little pieces of paper and these numbers in this computer mean something. True. And true. So the same thing with Bitcoin. It's just a collective belief that this is money, you know. What do you think about sort of this idea right now? I don't know if you follow this at all, but, like, right now they're trying to regulate crypto in our government right now. What is your thoughts on that as someone who follows crypto.
Yeah. And I dabble.
You dabble.
It's interesting. I mean, I think the, you know, one of the big marketing I like that. That's a good comment, Bonnie. Thank you so much.
Only fans will give you more than $5. Yes, indeed.
But what will Bonnie give me? That's what I want to know. I'm on the market with
She'll give you maple flavored treats. That's right.
You know, one of the things I really liked about crypto is that they said, hey, this is a way that we've created more millionaires in the US than ever before in history with this vehicle. Like, not corporations, not whatever. We've created all this. And I thought, well, that's really cool. It's almost like the democratization of being able to get wealthy and having it maybe for once, not just the rich keep getting richer, right?
Right.
At the same time, it just depends on what crypto wants to be. If it wants to be this wild gamble that you can take and maybe you hit it and maybe you go bankrupt, cool. But if you want to start thinking about it as a real financial instrument where people can put their teachers' retirements funds could get invested in this kind of thing and want to see growth that wasn't regulated by the stock market or whatever, then it would need some controls, right? Because you can't trust your retirement to a wild vehicle like that. And unfortunately, sometimes people don't understand the risk that they're taking. And if it's your retirement, you don't want to take that kind of risk.
Yeah. No, I feel that, but what do you think about the government sort of, because you're saying, since it's a decentralized thing, you're right, like, we're able to take the American dream, that idea of the American dream, and really disseminate it and really sort of distribute it in a fair way, to where if you do the research and you sort of look into it and you know, you can really make some money off of this system.
Yeah.
But what do you think about them trying to regulate that now, like, and try to centralize it, sort of how arson, and when you look at different countries like Australia is looking to go into crypto system, and Argentina already, I think it's Argentina or is it Venezuela? One of those South American countries just got rid of the American dollar, which the American dollar was their currency, and now it's just Bitcoin. So what do you think about trying to centralize it? And I mean, maybe you don't even think about it, but which is fine too, but I'm just curious.
I think there's two sides to the coin. The downside of the centralization would be government control and maybe like less upside than before. The upside that I like about it, and maybe this time in the world, is countries like China have just said crypto's banned.
Yeah.
And we're not going to play it all. So if you do centralize it, you also legitimize it.
Yeah.
And I would encourage everybody to remember that fact, because you know, they honestly, the government could be like, this is going to disappear tomorrow. Yeah. Goodbye. And then everything that you put in would be. So the legitimacy is something that we have to consider too.
I believe it was El Salvador. Yes. Thank you, Gail. But that's the thing about crypto is that the government could ban it if it's decentralized, the government could ban it from being used, but like you could still, it's on the blockchain. There's no, you're not losing that as a form of currency. Maybe you can't spend Bitcoin at the local market here, but you can definitely exchange it through different currencies to get to a currency you need, you know, and if that's in America, you could definitely do that. I think the problem is that it's already legitimate, and like it's too unstable for it to be like completely legit, like completely everybody being full hog into it. But I think as more people are coming to it and more people are using it, I think that's going to change. And by centralizing it, you're sort of taking away that power that it originally gave to the people. I'm really interested in this whole Web3 movement. Are you familiar with the Web3 thing that's going on, where everything's they want everything to be on blockchains, everything's sort of decentralized, putting all the processing in the power of the people instead of like Amazon deciding the arbiters of truth, and you know, deciding all of a sudden that they don't like Parler because they disagree with that platform, and so they deplatformed an entire fucking website because it's like, hey, we can just do that. So now Web3 moves us to a point where we're not relying on these people, these companies. They're not even people, even though in America we consider corporations people. Fucking assholes.
Very silly. Yeah.
But you know, like they just decide what you can see, what you can hear, what you can do. So with Web 3, what people are looking at is a sort of decentralized web where we're able to sort of navigate around these gatekeepers again, because that's originally what the internet was
for.
I mean, it was for just, you know, sending, you know, messages and information between scientists, but then it turned into the thing that happened when it was unleashed into the world, which who knows if that could have even been predictable, but it completely took a lot of power out of government's hands, and where the power was is information. And now information can be spread and you know, distributed without a filter of propaganda, and that was just one aspect of it. But still, people want something tangible, so it's hard to sell the idea of crypto to the masses. And I get that when you're used to one thing your whole life, I mean, and this new thing that's unstable as shit comes in, and you know, like I get it. But I do think that as more people come to it, it's going to get stable. And if the government doesn't, you know, take it and just defile it, then it's going to be something beautiful, I think. And I remember back in 2013 hearing about Bitcoin when it was like 25 cents a fucking coin. And they're just like, dude, get into this. You got to get into it. Like, I remember hearing Joe Rogan podcast, this crazy dude talking about it. I was like, maybe I should get some Bitcoin. And they were like, dude, just buy some Bitcoin and hold on to it. And I guarantee in 10 years, you're going to be just fine. 10 fucking years later, everybody's doing just fine.
Yeah. Anyway. Okay, give me 30 seconds. Please, I'll be right back to you.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I forgot you needed coffee. Okay, Baron's going to go and get caffeinated real quick. So we're gonna give him a moment. It's a big shift. Physical money has existed for thousands of years, and all of a sudden there's something new and invisible. Well, and that is the internet in itself, right? Like, that was new. And that's what, you know, people feared that, I suppose, but now it's like our whole thing. What the fuck happened here? How did this all of a sudden become a thing right here? Why is that there now? Why is there a big hole in my fucking set now? Okay, I'll just turn like this and no, there won't be a hole. I don't know. It's a weird time. And Snarf Music, I saw your question. I'm so sorry. It's been 30 minutes, but we will get to your question. I promise. I mean, Gail, what are we going to do, Gail? What are we going to do if they centralize crypto? It's not going to be any fun anymore. It's just going to be sitting here like, well, this is boring and all centralized. Decentralized forever, baby. That's what I'm saying. That's why I'm really excited about this, the prospect of Web3. I mean, imagine the possibilities of not having to worry about, you know, getting information that's been filtered 20 times or the same headline is just being distributed to the same news or different news organizations all owned by the same conglomerates, all brought to you by Pfizer. So, oh man, people will always find a way to fly under the radar. I agree, but like that's what they're trying to, yeah, I turned it up. The things are off. We'll do it over. Oh, Baron's back. We'll
come back. Brought to you by Pfizer.
Here, we'll do the real one. Hold on. Here, this is a.
Brought to you by Pfizer. Fuck you. Pay me.
Okay, well, that sucked. And then there's the new one, which I don't think is gonna work either. Okay, sweet. Nothing's working.
Oh, that was gonna be our jam.
I know. Nothing's working today, folks. Everything is eating shit because whatever.
Omicron.
Watch out, everybody. Omicron is coming to town. Yeah. Yeah. So and now we are canceled. There you go.
Brought to you by Pfizer. Fuck you. Pay me.
There you go.
I love that. I won't, there's a member of my community, I won't dox them, who works at Pfizer. And this person was like, my Pfizer stock is looking better than ever.
I bet. I bet. That, I wish I would have gotten in on Pfizer at the beginning, too. God damn. Their earnings was like $11 billion or something in the first quarter of this year. And it's just like, holy fuck. Like, it's just an ungodly amount of money. So when people are thinking, you know, like, when you see how much Pfizer is invested in news organizations and politicians and vaccines and opiate crisis and all this stuff,
yeah,
you know, it always boggles the mind to think, like, why wouldn't these people lie to make that much money at any cost? Right. At any cost. And, you know, and again, I just want to put this out there. I'm not against the vaccines, folks. I'm not against it. Go get vaccinated.
Canceled.
I'm not against vaccines. I am questioning the vaccine. That's all. And like, there's a lot of questions that I have. And the fact that I can't ask these questions without people getting angry or saying I'm fomenting hesitancy or whatever the fuck kind of stupid little hot words you guys want to throw, not you guys, but like people want to throw at people who question this. I think it's ridiculous because like for instance, it's really interesting. And I'm sorry that we even went down this road, but I have to say this, the fact like I got in like into this sort of argument. I was on a podcast like a couple weeks ago and their entire chat turned on me because I was talking about this. And again, I didn't say don't go get vaccinated. I'm just asking questions. Okay. And the fact that I was saying, that the vaccines don't really do a lot of stuff for transmitting the virus, you know, they freak the fuck out. But what's happening now? Oh, the CDC, and now all these headlines are coming out saying how ineffective that these vaccines are. So just a couple weeks ago, it was a conspiracy theory. I was a conspiracy theorist. But yeah. Now, all of a sudden, these fucking articles are coming out where they're recognizing this. And they're recognizing that myocarditis is a side effect and that it is a very high probable cause that it's a side effect. So, you know, it's just really interesting that what was 2 weeks ago was conspiracy theory is now sort of becoming part of the narrative. And so it's this slow rollout of shit news that they've been doing. 2 weeks to flatten the curve. You know what I mean? It's safe and effective. It's 99% effective on stopping transmission, all this stuff. Slowly do they just tell us all the bullshit that's happening. Like, same thing with the lab leak. It's like, last year you were getting deplatformed for saying lab leak, and now it's probably true it was a lab leak, but no one gives a fuck, so who cares? Anyways, there's nothing wrong with doing legit research base, especially for questions that laymen's in the medical and epidemiological field. Sorry, I suck at reading. We speak English good.
I will. I'll just say this, sure. And this comes from growing up in Europe. My dad was military, so I grew up in Germany. And I am used to, I think that's my critique of American politics on both sides of the aisle, I would say, is that in Germany, they all have like 7 parties or 9 parties mm-hmm. or 8 governors or whatever. And you get a lot more used to being able to question beliefs and take like, I might take like 80% of my beliefs from the Democrats or 80% from the mm-hmm. Republicans and 20%. And that the sort of like variation within the parties is much more tolerated because they're used to having 8 parties that yeah. form a parliament of government. Over here, it does seem, and I'm not, I guess I'm poking holes at both sides, that if you deviate on an issue, it's like, fuck you. And that's my critique of all of it. You know what I mean?
Epidemiological. Snarf, thank you. But you don't know any of that. You are repeating conspiracy theories that people put out and get themselves attention and money. Cartagena, what the fuck are you talking about? Can we please just pull up some articles saying fucking transmission, Omicron, fully vaccinated? Let's just see what happens. Omicron, what you need to know, the virus from the CDC government. The new variant was reported to the World Health Organization, Omicron classified, we've been collaborating with private health. Can you blah, 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 blah. Where is it? How easily does Omicron spread? The Omicron variant is likely to spread easily, more easily than the original SARS-CoV-2 virus. How easily Omicron spreads compared to Delta is unknown. Or Delta, CDC experts expects that anyone with Omicron infection can spread the virus to others, even if they are vaccinated and don't have symptoms. Fucking read it yourself, Cartagena. It's right fucking here on the CDC website. Okay? It's not conspiracy theories anymore, I guess. Okay? Okay, Cartagena, I love you. And you keep me honest. You keep me honest. And thank you for that. God damn it, thank you for that. I love you, Cartagena. You fucking keep me honest. Anyways, please, I'm sorry that was interrupted. Were you finished? I'm sorry.
I guess so. I just got a DM from Destiny Garrett, and it said, quote, "Don't bring up O.J. Simpson."
What's wrong with OJ?
I don't know. I was fucking... like, do people still talk about OJ Simpson?
Yeah, what happened with OJ? Let's see.
I honestly don't know. Okay. I just thought it was a funny thing to say.
OJ Simpson. Hold on. We're in it now. What's going on with OJ? OJ murder case. No. Early release. OJ Simpson's robbery victim has no problem with parole ending early. Well, that's good. That's 3 days ago. A murder case like O.J. Simpson trial, California wife tried for killing. Okay, great. Okay, so let's look at the TMZ.
That's a good source for news, right?
Yeah, good source for good news. And you stay, look at this guy. You could just tell this guy with the mustache has it all figured out. Look at this guy. No, have you ever read his book, If I Had Done It? I think that's what it's called. Have you ever read that book?
You asking me?
Yeah, yeah.
The book?
Yeah.
What book?
O.J. Simpson wrote a book called If I Had Done It.
Oh.
I really
know nothing. I really know nothing really? About this topic.
It's an incredible book, by the way. I suggest everyone go read it. How dare you? But they are putting that out there. Yeah, Cartagena. But think about 2 weeks ago when people were saying that if you said that the vaccines don't slow down transmission if you said that like a month ago, you were fucking considered an idiot or a conspiracy theorist or a piece of shit or fucking fomenting hesitancy. And now it's right there on the CDC website. That's what I'm saying. Like, it's madness. It's just they keep telling us all these stupid things to keep our hopes alive, keep us falling in line, keep us doing what we're told, and then they just go against it anyways. They'll just be like, oh, well, guess what? It doesn't matter anyways. Yeah, fuck it. We're just going to keep going. Go get vaccinated, stupid. Again, people, get vaccinated. Don't listen to me. Don't listen to the fucking bear in the bard. Talk to your doctor. Make sure the vaccines are right for you because guess what? They can fucking kill you as well. So you might not be able to take the vaccine. So just to be aware, but not against the vaccine. Thank you, Bonnie, for that. I'm not against the vaccine, folks. I'm just asking questions. If you want to be protected, it does show that it protects people from dying and hospitalization. So the evidence is in. So please, you know, go do what's good for you and your family. I don't want to be the person to change your mind about whatever. But I'm asking questions, and I'm not going to stop. Did you see the cruise ship story today, Mike? Not a great example of them working. Oh, no. But no, my friend's daughter got coronavirus. My friend's daughter is unvaccinated, but everyone at her daycare is vaccinated, including the kids, and she got coronavirus. So, no, I mean, it's just ridiculous. If I Did It, Confessions of a Killer, 3.25 out of 5.
That's a great rating.
They still need more data about Omicron, which needs more time. Of course. But what I'm saying...
I like the Goodreads rating. What's our Goodreads rating, by the way, Mike?
Our Goodreads rating, it was probably 4 out of 5. Now it's probably gone down about 1.2 out of 5. Now that we're talking about OJ and and vaccines, right. The rating has gone completely out the window.
So I have a question for you. I want you to finish your thread there, but I got one for you.
We're done.
So I'm hearing little different pieces, and they're coming together in my mind as I kind of conceptualize who Mike is.
Oh Lord.
You have a little bit of a libertarian power to the people perspective, I'm hearing. Is that right? Is that fair?
It's really interesting that that's what it's turned into, but I've always considered myself like ultra liberal. And what's interesting is that over the past 10 years or so, that ultra liberal has taken on a new meaning. Where ultra liberal now means do what you're told, don't question anything, don't say certain things. Freedom of speech is not that is just fomenting hate. Is freedom of speech, freedom of expression is you are now on the right. Yeah, exactly, Carter. And that's what sucks is now I'm like, because I support. So I support gun rights. I support the cops, but like I don't support the I support people, anybody who decides to put on that shield and go and protect their people. But I don't support the institution that protects criminals, and like cops can be. That institution can protect criminals within that institution. I don't support that at all. But you know, like I support freedom of speech. I support our troops, and like because I support these things, now all of a sudden I'm some right winger. But guess what? I also support fucking abortion. I support fucking women's rights. I support trans rights, LGBTQ rights. If you want a pronoun, if you want to be addressed as fairy princess, I will address you as fairy princess with a smile on my face and mad respect because I love you, and I think that you shouldn't, you know, feel. Everyone should feel like they have a place to stand, but not at the cost of our liberties to express ourselves freely, because that's the only way that this country has become the fucking country that it has become, done beautiful things and atrocities and horrible atrocities and lots of racism, and racism still exists. I'm not saying that it doesn't. It's just that because I have these certain thoughts, now I'm this libertarian or right-wing weirdo, when really I'm pretty left when it comes to certain things. It's just I'm not so left that I'm going to give up these basic rights that I feel like, you know, are the tenets and the bedrock of this country. You know, like it's what made us cool. It's what brought us hip hop. It's what brought us rock and roll, man. It's what brought us fucking some of the greatest art this world has ever known. So whatever.
Right.
Say what you need to say about America and its atrocities, but hey, chances to die of vaccine is, I think, 1,000 times less than COVID. Yeah, that's fine, Snarf. And you know, I'm that's why I'm saying go talk to your doctor. That's why I'm saying, you know, you might die. There is a chance that you might die or have serious repercussions from this vaccine. That's why I say go talk to your doctor. And I'm not against the vaccine. Go get vaccinated. I told my mom to get vaccinated. She fucking, you know, she has pre-existing conditions. I'm not against the vaccines, folks. I'm just fucking saying. I'm just asking questions. That's all. I don't think that's wrong. And that's why I don't like the idea of people saying freedom of speech is you know, fomenting hate, because I think that being able to question things is why we become this country that we've become. I mean, well, or at least I know a lot of people hate this country right now, but I still think there's good here. I'm sorry, Baron. I'm talking. If memory serves me right. Yeah. No, Snark. You're absolutely right. And again, I'm not saying don't take the vaccine. Please don't take that away from me. From this conversation, I'm not saying
I don't think they're taking it away. You've
I know, I know, but I gotta say that over and over again because this is gonna go to YouTube, and my shit's already been taken down a couple times off of YouTube because of talks like this. So I have to say it every fucking time so that they know I'm not trying to say don't take the vaccine. I'm just simply asking questions. And everyone, go talk to your fucking doctor. Don't listen to the fat guy in Ohio. Go talk to your doctor and see if the vaccines are right for you. Anyways.
Yeah. Yeah. No, but I mean, I would say to all of that is that it is certainly your right as a citizen to take beliefs from both camps. And yeah. I think we can all do a better job of being open to beliefs that are different than ours.
I agree.
And I'm not here to say line by line what I agreed with of yours and what I didn't agree with of yours, but I didn't have any issue with you having a platform either.
Yeah.
And I think that's a way we can all get better for sure.
Yeah. And it's just like these platforms, when people want to deplatform people because they don't agree with them, is like that's the whole point. It's like these platforms exist because people don't agree with each other, but it's through these platforms that we can sort of get to know what other people are thinking. And so we can kind of get a better idea of how the world is functioning rather than just sort of confirmation bias, living in your little bubble of people who agree with you over and over again. And you know, that's dangerous. It's just dangerous. It's not a good way to go, because if the pendulum swings too far to one side, well, killing fields of Cambodia, you know? And if it goes the other side, you know, there's, you fucking, what was it? What is like the worst examples of a conservative regime? I don't know. No dancing at the parties. I don't know. No abortions. I don't know. Those are bad examples, everyone. But I'm saying, if you let things go too far on either side without any sort of balance of talking about it or not being able to talk about it, we end up with extremes on both sides, and you end up creating extremists on both sides, which we've seen. We've seen people who in the name of equality are burning down cop stations, and people who in the name of their own personal rights and freedoms, they went and smashed into the Capitol building, you know? So like both sides have their extremists, which are created in these echo chambers, and that's the problem, and that's the danger. Let ladies do what they want to their own bodies. Yeah, exactly. I think it's stupid. I think it's completely stupid to tell people what to do with their own shit. It's like, fuck you. Like, leave me alone.
I'm okay with the banning the dancing at the parties, though, because I don't want the world to know my limitations. And the expectation of dance is hard for me.
Well, now that needs to be a redeemable thing on your channel.
I can do like the swim. I think the swim is like my go-to.
Yeah, mine is the two-step. I just do the two-step. And luckily my wife can dance, so like if it's like some ratchet shit, all I gotta do is put up my hands and she does all the work, and I just sit there and look sweet with like this girl rubbing her big ass booty on me. I'm just like, yeah, bitch. Right. Yeah, girl.
They do
blessed.
Yeah.
Hashtag blessed.
Put it on the gram so other people can compare. Right?
Exactly. It's like, hey, everybody, I have a big booty on my shit. How about you?
Yeah.
Thank you, bud. Well, you know, it's interesting you brought up Germany, too, because it's like Germany completely forgot about their history right now. I don't know if you've seen what's going on in Germany, but it's like really wild over there. It's like people are, you know, the unvaccinated can't go anywhere. It's all vaccine passports. It's like they're shaming the kids. Like if you're not, every day, and this might be propaganda, everybody, for our German residents, maybe you can clear it up for me so I can stop spreading misinformation. But tell me if this is not true. They are bringing kids up front every day and to say their vaccine status. And if they're not vaccinated, they're questioned on why they're not vaccinated. Now, this is just reports I've been hearing on the TikTok or whatever. It's like most open and honest about their history. Oh, no. Germany is actually the most open and honest. No, I get it. But now all of a sudden people have to show their papers and question why they're making the decisions that they're making. All I'm saying is that Germany... It's kind of going down the same road as they once were. I don't want to go that far now, of course, but it is interesting that as and because I know that. I know that about Germany, Bonnie. I know that about Germany, that they are very open and they are very much like, we are not going to do that again. And they have, you know, they have laws against it. Like, you can't, like, freedom of speech doesn't exist there for a reason, which I don't agree with. But still, freedom of speech there does not exist because of certain things that happened in the past. And yet, we still see them. Show your papers. If the death rate of a virus was 20%, I think very few people would refuse the vax. Well, the death rate of the virus, is that what you're saying? Is the death rate of the, because the death rate of the virus isn't like the death rate, like it's like 99%. It's like not 99% death rate, but 99% that you won't die. It's like a very low percentage, right? I mean, 1 in 5 of all population died. Is that right? 1 in 5 died? Well, again, snarf music. I'm not trying to tell anybody not to take the vaccine. Again, you know. So, if 1 in 5 died. See, I'm confused by your whole thing there. Sorry. I'm. We speak English good. We read English bad. And we read English good, too. Let's get to this question here. Let's get away from all the... Let's get away from all the controversy, because that seems to be riling people up. And I don't want to rile you guys up. Not too much anyways. I honestly just want people to think for themselves. That's my thing. It's like, just think for yourselves, goddammit. Just fucking have some backbone. Okay, I just followed you, Baron. This is from Snarf. I followed Delta Cab recently. So how did you guys meet and end up jamming in person? That's awesome. And I agree with that, by the way.
Yeah. So it was actually Delta who did a really good job of pulling together a bunch of New England area streamers. We had a little hangout in downtown Boston. And he also brought InfoZar, who's one of Twitch's only magicians, who's a really cool guy in person as well. And the stuff that he does is insane.
Wait, there's a Twitch magician?
He is.
What's the name?
It's Info X Czar, Czar. He's been featured on quite a few channels from the folks around here as well. But yeah, so if you ever want like a good bar trick, this guy's got you covered. He's like, let me show you a couple things you can do to win free drinks. Ask for dates if I can guess your card, blah, 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 whatever. He's got you totally covered.
I think I did it wrong. What is Info Czar? Is that what you said?
It would be like this.
Sausage. Oh. Okay. Thank you, Bonnie. I appreciate you. So he organized it, is what you're saying? Is that
Delta
organized it, and they got you guys together.
Yeah, yeah.
And so, wait, what did you guys do? You guys came together and you just met up downtown Boston?
Yeah, yeah. We went out. We had a couple drinks. Yeah, it was a good time. I know that Delta is really big about connecting musicians, which is super cool. A little bit of a lost art, I think, in the digital era. You know, I wasn't obviously around to know how it was maybe in the earlier days, but it does seem like, you know, people get together and be like, oh, you know, Metallica met at a bar, and like, oh, I know this guy who plays drums like down the street from me or whatever, right? Yeah. And that's how kind of connectivity. So yeah, all credit to Delta for setting it up, and it was awesome to have him out here too. So
that's dope. I love that. And that's what I want to do. I'm trying to get, I was supposed to do it with Matt Suarez because we went to see Dave Matthews at the Gorge together, and then we drove back here, and he went down to Glowstick Willie's Festival and did that with Jory and Liz Vega and stuff. And I was supposed to go do that, but I ended up getting busy. But yeah, man, like I love the idea of doing those, like meeting up with people. Like I want to do that with Gail. Gail, I want to go and meet up because Gail is close enough. Like she's 6 hours away that where we could go. I want to invade Gail's space and like throw my BDE all over her really nice space Gail setup, which sounds This sounds gross. Sorry, Gail.
It did. I won't lie to you.
I'm sorry, Gail. I am. Oh, God.
She's basically got the Starship Enterprise. I think it's a Star Trek reference going on her streams. For anybody who doesn't know. And yeah. She's got a beautiful voice, too, by the way. So check out Gail.
Gail's
for sure.
Incredible. I love Gail very much. Yeah, thanks, Bonnie. I appreciate you, emphasizing that.
Such supportive moderators, too, right?
She is. Actually, Bonnie is very supportive. She fattened me up all weekend because that's what I need in my life. I'm puffy. I don't know if you guys can see this, but I'm very puffy from eating sweets and treats. Baron's like looking like, is he puffy?
Yeah, I couldn't see.
Here we go. Hold on. I'll get you. It's puffy. Just look.
Oh, there you go.
There's a little puffiness, right?
Look at that.
It's a little puffy. I don't like this puffiness. It's not great. It's not great. So, Baron, were you? So, what is it that you do then? Like, what's your day job? If you don't mind talking about that.
Yeah, I can cover that for sure. So basically, I got into technology and. It's been really cool. And in a nutshell, I'm out here selling software, and it's not like the kind of like necessarily cool or exciting brand new technology stuff, but it is the gears that make corporate America sort of run. So all those big enterprise server farms and everything that you hear about, all that needs a lot of plumbing to make it work. So we call it plumbing because it's not sexy, but it's very necessary. And those are the kind of things that the technology does.
sometimes some aspects of technology is not very sexy, but I think that it's still important. You know, right. Like my friend, he has a business that sells these little things that you put in your basement or wherever, and it detects floods. And it's just a little piece of technology that if it has water rising, it alerts the thing, and you know, like. That's not very sexy at all, but like that's very useful for people. And he said his clients are mostly like the wealthy because they always have like these estates that sit for years or months at a time, and so having these things. I think it's cool. So what parts do you work on in that field then? In the field you work, like where are you in that?
You could say broadly automation. So if you want to think about it as like, you know, we think of traditional, like maybe when I say automation, what comes to mind is like a machine that flips over a burger at McDonald's. If you think about that metaphor, there's a lot of that needs to happen in internet systems, right? There's a lot of little things that can be automated. And if you remember, who was the presidential candidate that wore the hat that said math? Yeah. That's it. Andrew Yang, right?
Yep.
Yeah. He actually touched on many of the issues that we're kind of helping to do.
Have you read his book?
I have not, but I think I would probably like it.
It's the saddest fucking thing you'll ever read. It's amazing.
Really?
Yeah. It's
what's the premise? What's the highlight of it?
The highlight is we're all doomed.
Yeah.
That's literally, I mean, hey, Dizzle, welcome in. Yes, we want to know his day job. Exactly. Oh, would have helped out RZA back in the day. Yeah, I bet. Woo! Please, go ahead.
I mean, yeah, I would say there's always two sides to the coin, right? Mm-hmm. There's a view of there'll be nothing left to do and the robots will replace us and would die. And then there's sort of the view of like, well, we probably need less population than we did before because... the robots will be doing more, but...
Oh, so you're with Bill Gates and thinning out the herd.
I mean, if you... Yes.
Yeah, I mean, that's why he released the virus, right?
Right.
I'm just kidding, everybody. Bad jokes.
Canceled. You're canceled. but you could also certainly say that, like, now nobody has to do the job of flipping the burgers.
Right.
And so for the period before it all ends... humans are going to have the luxury of doing jobs that they actually want to do. Maybe that's producing music. Maybe that's making a podcast. You know what I mean?
Right. But on the other hand, not everyone is a podcaster. Not everyone's music. Not everyone has that talent or fortitude to do these things. So what happens to the people who aren't so motivated, who are just going to sort of sit around and not have any kind of special skills, like, because I think the only people that are really going to have a dog in this race are coders and engineers, and even them eventually will be thinned out. And even if we could take it a step further, there's the idea that musicians and artists will be eliminated as well. So, you know, what to do then?
I don't know.
Well, I mean, have you ever heard Germany and Bill Gates? Who pissed in your mushroom bowl today? Listen, Moving Dutchman. Am I wrong about what I'm saying? That's what I'm saying. Am I wrong? Just tell me if I'm wrong. What's up, Morby? Good to see you, my friend. Yo, we got more than enough resources. We just need to learn how to share. By the way, hi, y'all. I don't think that depopulation is necessarily the answer. And I think you're absolutely right, Morby. We do have the resources. It's just we are deciding that only a few people get to have access to those resources, and the rest of us are just sort of clawing at the bit and turning on each other and hating each other and canceling each other while we're being robbed blind. Yeah,
that does it. Technology. That's a good summary of this podcast. I feel like that should be your slogan right there.
We're being robbed blind by a select few.
Yeah, man. I was told we were going to talk music. How did we get here?
Well, we did. We talked a lot about music. I think that NFT and the SoundCloud. I mean, that was incredible. I enjoyed that very much.
Me too.
But this is what it's really about.
The good is coming out, Mike.
This is what it's all about. Forever preach. Welcome in. Yes, it is a necessary evil. Fortunately, unfortunately, yes. No. Well, like, so there's kind of, you know, Andrew Yang's book. It just, you know, he ends with an offering of a solution, of a half-assed solution, which is IB, what is that? Universal Basic Income, so UBI. And maybe, yes, we'll have, you know, the people who don't have any real skills will, you know, just live their basic lives, hopefully without creating too much of a carbon footprint, which probably won't. That probably won't happen. But, you know, we'll see. You know, the sad thing is just it turns into Ready Player One. I mean, with the metaverse coming in, with the whole Neuralink, which I know you said you weren't sure what that is. Neuralink is a interactive. They're gonna be basically, you're gonna be able to surf the internet with your mind. They're gonna put nodes into your brain, which they already are, and by end of 2022, they're gonna be doing this to humans. They're already doing it to pigs and stuff. Cancel culture is kind of an illusion, but it does affect people in small town America. And Greenwich Crafts, hi. Hello, I'm sorry I didn't say hi. I've seen you. Have you seen the movie Don't Look Up? Not yet, but I'll check it out. Oh shit, where was I? Chat always gets me confused. What was I just saying? What we're just talking about?
You were talking about UBI.
Yeah, so UBI is basically the solution that Andrew Yang is putting forth. Right. And then with Neuralink and the metaverse coming, those are going to be distractions while the world sort of falls apart around us. And, you know, overpopulation probably does take over and people don't relinquish their resources, because why would the top 1% who are making all that money want to stop making all that money? That just goes against human nature. Greed is just something that is in it's just embedded into us, and it comes from, you know, not wanting to starve to death. Right. So, you know, whatever. Yeah, I love Yang too. I love Yang too, but his book is just fucking sad as shit. Yuri, what's his name? Yuri something. What's his name? Yuri. He wrote 12 or 24 lessons. Yuri. 24 lessons or 21 lessons for the 21st century. In that, he's talking about how, Yuval Noah Harari, my bad. Yuval Noah Harari talks about this as well. And actually, Andrew Yang references him. But he's talking about how artists will be eliminated as well, because we're going to get to that point. And again, with Neuralink, with the metaverse, with data collection, you got to think about that they're going, like, whatever AI system is operating for you personally, they're going to be able to dig into your memories, create a music, create imagery that touch on certain memories from your past, your future, not future, but your past, your present. They're going to be able to hit on, you know, the nuances. It's going to be able to release smells into your brain that take you back and transport you to different places. So, like, the AI is going to tailor your own personal art to you, leaving artists just dying in the streets from starvation. So, whatever. It's a necessary evil that's going to create a really interesting, sad world if we don't get a grip on it now. Forever Preach. What did you say? Andrew Yang and the money. Yeah. The trailer is infuriating. Well, what we should probably look at. UBI is being tested in Canada. Not a good look. Really? It's not working out? We're just going to have a big orgy and then on. They can't take that from us. No. Well, that's what's interesting about the Neuralink, though, right? Like, we'll be able to experience heroin. We'll be able to experience orgies, experience being a woman if you're a man. Like, experience what it's like to be, starving in Africa, without being that. You know, having this hook directly into your brain. Having safe sex is never going to be safer, you know? And you're still gonna wake up with a mess in your pants. So it'll be great. It's just we won't be doing it together because the next variant is surely coming down the barrel. So we're just gonna always be like they're getting us used to right now this isolated lifestyle that we're going into as automation comes in and takes over. We're gonna be entertained to death as the world crumbles around us, and we'll be in our little pods with our Neuralink, happy as shit, and we'll just be like in Wall-E. We'll just be fat gelatinous people rolling around in our fucking rascals, fucking eating our food through a straw, fucking just constantly being fucking inundated in the fucking metaverse and fucking and eating and fucking and living our lives until we die alone in our little pods and we're found like a year later because no one gives a fuck about you and no one cared enough to come looking for you. Any thoughts?
Everybody have a great week.
Merry Christmas, everyone.
Let's and break.
And see. But that's the sad world that Andrew Yang painted and Yuval Noah Harari is sort of painting. If we don't sort of take back our independence and take back our lives, I mean, we are completely handing our lives over to this technology. And yes, it's going to be necessary. And honestly, I don't see why we're not letting our children on the fucking device. Fuck it. This is our life. You think that shit's going anywhere? And like parents who are like, don't fucking let your kids on their devices for too long. Well, guess what? You think that those devices are going anywhere? You don't think that device is going to be implanted in their head by the time they're 18 anyways? Fuck it. Let your kids on fucking YouTube forever. You just got to be responsible about what they're watching. I mean, it's very simple. You just got to be a good parent. What about music, though? Boyan, you know better than anybody that we don't talk about music here. Should we start talking about Dave Chappelle now? No, I'm just kidding. I'm sorry, Boyan. Me and Boyan, we were talking about Dave Chappelle and that fun conversation. But no, actually, Destiny had a question. What are our thoughts on Dolly Parton? Let's take it back to music. What's your thoughts on Dolly?
Is there some new news about Dolly Parton that I'm not aware of?
I'm not sure. Let's look. Let's look at the latest Dolly Parton news. What's Dolly up to?
Yeah, so I'm like,
I'm literally Googling Dolly Parton news. Dolly Parton scores 3 Guinness World Records. Yes, good news. Good news out of Nashville.
Miss Dolly Parton and E.T. has spent decades with Dolly, all the way up to her big all-star tribute.
All-star tribute. I'm just a backward Garth.
Barbie. This is a Pink. Big deal. Pink. Huge. And I am very proud, and I'm just dying to hear all these wonderful singers sing my music. Here I go!
We've all been Dolly fans forever.
She is incredible. She's funny. She's talented in every avenue. I love her so much.
She doesn't really let me call her a godmother. She likes fairy godmother much better.
Aww. I love one of these things that she said, which was, people ask me why my feet are so small, and I say, things don't grow in the shade.
She just makes me feel really brave.
Show feet.
Because she is still...
Where's the feet? We want to see feet. Nope, just everyday Dolly conversation. Well, Dolly sets 3 Guinness World Records. So we have Dolly news. We have Dolly news. She's dope. Yeah, I agree, Boyan. I agree. Dolly is dope. She's bringing literature to all the youth through her charity work. Well, isn't that one? Look, there's no way. I love country. Yeah, exactly. Nope, just everyday Dolly comment. Also, she seems to be so kind. Yes, I agree. I agree. I don't think that anyone has anything bad to say about Dolly. And I can't imagine anybody who would have something bad to say about Dolly probably sucks. You know what I mean? Like, she's that kind of person. It's like, yeah. I say this about my wife, too, because, like, if you have something bad to say about my wife, because she's so nice that, like, you probably suck. Because my wife is like my wife is so nice that people think that it's an act. It's not. I mean, obviously, she has her times and, you know, she has her downtime. But still, like, they used to think that she was fake and until they got to know her. And it's like, oh, shit, you just are always that person. So it's like she's just always that person. So anybody who's criticizing Dolly because she's too nice and she's this and that, blah, 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 it's because they're assholes. Simply, it's because they're assholes. Let's look at this. Let's look. Watch this video. All right, singer-songwriter Dolly Parton. How does it feel to add a 4th record under your belt that you broke?
Well, I feel like a bird that wants to fly away. Actually, getting the first one was really an amazing thing to me, and I thought just to be in the Guinness Book of World Records one time would be great. And now that I've got all this going, it's just like an amazing feeling. I'm very honored, very proud, and I've had a lot of people helping me get to here, so thanks to all of you and to all of them for helping me have all this.
She has to
that
be
was such an uplifting note to kind of wrap up with, isn't it?
I agree. I agree. Like, out of all the things, you know, we talked about today, like, let's just reflect on how genuine and generous Dolly Parton is.
Yes.
And how she has all these, like, folksy little lines that she's going to say to everyone. Like, whatever she said. I feel like a bird that can't fly or something. What did she say? I got to know what she said now.
Bird that wants to fly away.
I feel like a bird that wants to fly away. Dear God, make me a bird. So, yeah, we'll be wrapped. Let's get through this article, and then we'll say our final goodbyes, and then we'll let our good friend Baron go, because I'm sure Baron has to go pee or something and live his life. So, talk about...
Potentially a little bit badly, yep.
Potentially. okay. Okay, so you know what, Barrett, why don't we just let you go, because I don't want you sitting here pissing your pants or anything. So here, we'll let you go, and we'll say our goodbyes to Barrett. Barrett, is there anything you want to leave us with? And by the way, everybody, which I never really did at all here, go and follow Barrett. Make sure that you're on his Twitch. He also has an Instagram, which I just went and followed. He just reactivated for us. He did that for us, everybody. He did that for us. So make sure you go follow him on his Instagram and on his stuff. And be sure to show him all the love. Barrett, is there any final words that you want to impart with us before you leave into this great unknown?
No, man, this is a fun conversation. I appreciate your thoughts and your questioning mentality. I think that's great. And if you find a way to strike it rich on those NFTs, dude, I want in. And I want in before the pop, you know what I mean? Give me in at the $10 photo of you know, your toes before it becomes a $10 photo.
Yeah, I'll call them the TOS coins.
Hey, let's go. TOES coins.
TOES coins, baby. All right. Baron the Bard, everybody. Give him a round of applause. Hey.
Thank you.
No worries, my friend. I'll talk to you later.
See you later.
Woo! What in the fuck that bothers me so much? Oh my god. Okay, Baron, Boyan, thank you. Boyan, thank you so much for popping in for Baron. I appreciate you, my friend. And I hope you're doing well. I hope you're doing well out there in La La Land. And I'm not saying you're in La La Land. I'm in Los Angeles. I mean, I'm sure you got it. I just don't want you to think I'm making fun of you. I know I can be off-putting, friends. I know I can be off-putting. Destiny, thank you so much for being here. I hope you... You know what? Let's read through this Dolly article. Might as well finish this Dolly article. I want to know what she got what she won these for. If you guys don't mind, you better be off-putting. I am off the pudding. I am. I'm getting way too fat. Parton added... okay. Here we go. So the 75-year-old country star broke the records for most decades, 7, and most number one hits, 25, on the Billboard U.S. country charts.